standing in for Melissa, one of the teaser questions for nonlinear thinking is, have you ever made a big change in your clinic and it did nothing? Right, so if you understand nonlinearity as the inputs and outputs being disproportional, sometimes people work very, very hard and spend lots of time and lots of effort on something that it's kind of a trial, try it, see if it works implementation plan. And then it turns out lots of resources down the road, no impact. Similarly, SWAT's example is the inverse of that, where a small pat on your back is not giving you just a small linear improvement, but maybe for you, that's a very reinforcing thing. And so that really moves the needle. And so the question becomes, we talked earlier about general quality improvement capacity, and I cited Abe. Actually, you missed that, Abe, but I did. And now we're kind of moving into, how would you resolve, if you're using these processes for general learning and coordination or general quality improvement capacities, how might you actually use the model to understand more EVP-specific capacities that are local to each setting? And you might ask, you know, let's link this, to further link this to our particular clinic and healthcare. So the traffic jam example always seems to resonate with people in terms of referrals, because they realize that they can't just wave a magic wand and change the number of patients in their care. They start to see that the interdependence between the people who refer to them, or whether or not the patient's need gets met or needs to be referred elsewhere, is not only an interdependence in the sense of human relations, but a time dependent relationship, and that there's delays there. And so that's where this continuous time model or a stock and flow model in system dynamics becomes so valuable. So the stocks are the states or the levels of variables. And so if you think about this, this is like if you did wave your magic wand and you suddenly froze the clinic, where would all the patients be? Where would all the providers be? And in our system, I talked earlier about our ubiquitous sources of data and stores of data. Many managers have those levels. They have the mean patients who get X, Y, or Z. But what they don't have is a good understanding of, in their local setting, what's driving those levels. And can they actually play with those levels and see what would actually give them the best bang for their buck, given these nonlinear relationships we were talking about? So, or address the multifinality concerns that you heard about when Alexander talked about systems, and try to improve, yes, our primary implementation goal, but ideally without ruining any other primary factors in the clinic that are also important quality goals. And so this metaphor is frequently used, a tub or a sink. It's basically to explain the basic principle of a differential equation, where with the highway, you can know exactly mathematically when you're going to slow down. And it's when the rate of on inflow to the highway exceeds those getting off, given the carrying capacity of the road. And so staff actually have traditionally found the idea that they're dealing with flows of patients through a variety of states in clinic care that either do or do not meet their need as a very intuitive sort of, again, way of thinking, or a way of formalizing their thinking in a model to understand this. So with a static observation, if this were our EVP reach variable, and we were thinking about clinic A, B, and C, then if you're just looking at quarterly performance measures like we do in the VA, you might think, I definitely want to be clinic A, right? But really, what ends up happening, maybe you guys have been in this situation, is maybe clinic A is the upper line here at quarter one, and at quarter two, they look bad, and then at quarter three, they bump back up. And if you start looking at things dynamically, the question starts to become, particularly in clinics that have a lot of instability, what's causing all this ongoing variability, and what can we do to actually try to better maximize and use our resources rather than having such inconsistencies? And so, to move to doing something like that, we've talked a lot about moving from this qualitative to quantitative model and trying to generalize nationally the modeling process, not the model itself in terms of a care delivery model that's the end-all, be-all solution, but rather to engage all the stakeholders, elicit their mental models, make them explicit in a formal algebraic and differential equation model. We use administrative data that everybody has, common procedural terminology for the encounter types. Everybody has it. Beverly Health Qualified Health Centers have it. It's not just in mental health, not just in VA. ICD-9 for patient diagnostic categories, so we're looking at cohorts of patients. So we're using the most generic parameters that we think apply I've been asked to consult for overweight and obesity in VA. They use the same parameters, same types of problems. They have different patient subpopulations. They have general programs, they have specialty programs, and the question starts to become, how do we best allocate our staffing resources? How do we best enact policies and procedures? So the parameters are generic in terms of what they are, but the values are locally specific, so we can respond to that question staff have of, well, why would it work here? And okay, it worked in Stockton, but I don't think it's gonna work here. Things are different here. So we can go through that process of making sure they have confidence in their data. We run the status quo, a reference mode system behavior related to our EDP reach problem. And again, it's a reminder, I don't know that this was said explicitly earlier, that it's a model of our system problem, our limited EDP reach problem. In our case, you're hearing a lot of overlap with that being the system, the healthcare system. But really, we actually don't exactly mean the healthcare system. We mean the dynamics of the problem, of which the healthcare system is, of course, a part. But that's what we're actually modeling. So then we run a bunch of scenarios that staff have always wanted to test, but weren't sure or couldn't get their colleagues on board to try. And in fact, the first clinic we did this with, they gave us 30 hypotheses, which I think fits back to the coordination problem we talked about at the top of the talk. They had no way to resolve their lack of consensus about what was going on. And so that's really, for me, moving from a facilitation qualitative frame, wanting to go from individual mental models to a shared model that's actually formally testable and that has the psychological safety to be wrong, to try things virtually without expending tons of resources and so forth, and without running the risk that you've gotten dozens of providers, even at a local level, dozens of providers on board, thousands of patients impacted, and if any of it goes wrong, they're calling their senators and their congresspersons. So the relative safety of doing it in a virtual model and prototyping ideas to find the best bang for your buck, or the best initial bet about the change you might make. And then after you've enacted the plan that you've identified through simulation, then you can use the model as a monitoring or evaluation tool to actually see. And I'll show you a picture of that real quick. This is cut off a little bit, but these are the kind of stages here. Participating, calibrating the model, simulating the scenarios, translating it to a change plan, and then evaluating it over time. And that's something you kind of iterate through over and over again. So we're trying to help them to understand how a general theory, how the same types of system dynamics, those same positive feedback loops that apply in electrical systems, chemical systems, hydro, thermal systems, etc., could actually emerge from locally specific resources and constraints. So we're kind of meeting that sweet spot of using the same generalizable theory and increasing systems thinking skill with staff, but actually staying local and tailored to their own capacities. And that's really critical. These are two clinics we're working with on our NIH grant. And as you can see, on the left and right, you could almost picture these as these sliders, right? For any one of these different parameters we might consider, they are in a different place. And if we just picked a single one of these things to target for change, we might not even move the needle. Menlo Park might be doing great on one measure, and Stockton might be struggling. So what we have in the bold are sort of like the patient demand factors, then we have the different provider disciplines that they have, whether they can do evidence-based prescribing versus evidence-based psychotherapy, and then whether or not they are doing self-referrals or have to go to specialty care, whether they have training programs, etc. It's reasonable to us that staff would want this approach to be tailored to their local setting, yet also we need a way of trying to generalize and scale our process of facilitating them around their local data. And that's why we're using all the R and GitHub and stuff, which I'll show you where that is later. So you've learned about this throughout the prior sessions. That becomes something closer to this. So everything that's in red here is an exogenous parameter that comes from the electronic health record. So we feed that in. So often we're running those generic codes that I talked about, CPT, ICD-9 or 10 now, et cetera. And we can update it for a new quarter with just a small change in the code. Or we can update it for a new clinic with just a new clinic ID. Right? So it can be locally tailored or time specific with very small change in our script. The code is the same code, same definitions, et cetera. And then, as we learned from Alexandra, we're zooming in and out. So when we say system behavior, and you guys learned in your exercise,
every single one of these, some of this looks growing linearly, this is hitting a steady state, this is declining in a nonlinear fashion. So you can zoom in on any part of the process. So Stockton and Menlo Park are different. One of them struggling with referrals, but the other struggling with scheduling. Then you can zoom in and look at that. And then the sliders by the exogenous variable are things that you play within your simulations. So you can say, like, what if we did change our no-show rate? Or what if the average time that people were spending in PTSD care, getting prolonged exposure, changed? Or what if we suddenly got a big influx of patients around Christmas because patients were depressed? And we can see what those impacts would look like in real time. And people can actually be sort of disabused of some of their notions when all of a sudden we have these smart boards and you can just say, oh, well, what do you think it really is? And you play with it. And so that mental model can quickly start to become more shared, like we've learned from the prior sessions. So this would sum up, with putting it together, this session, as you've heard the different introductory, this is the first introduction of modeling. But the modeling takes up actually the bulk of this. So our current CEU training has 3 months of the introductory stuff that you learn. So people are learning their system thinking skills. And then they're spending the last 3 months doing their iterative model testing to pick their change plans locally, or their implementation plans. There's a couple examples in this paper in administration and policy and mental health and mental health services research of some of the simulations that we ran. We've run others that we're submitting now. And with that, in our remaining few minutes, I want to hand it over to David. If you guys want to see any of these prototypes of our R facilitation guides and so forth, they're all on our team GitHub page. So we're continuing to prototype on them. We want them to all be accessible, reproducible, and so forth, so people can just download them and run the code themselves.